Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Distilled, A Natural History of Spirits, by Rob DeSalle and Ian Tattersall, narrated by Asa Siegel. Publisher's note: this audiobook will refer to visual elements included in the print and ebook editions of the book. Preface. After our two books, A Natural History of Wine and A Natural History of Beer, a companion volume on distilled spirits might seem almost inevitable, but it is no afterthought. It is true that fermented beverages like wine and beer were around for millennia before some creative soul figured out how to make them into highly alcoholic spirits. But when distillation came about, this formidable technological development didn't just pump up the alcohol. It radically broadened the range of gustatory experiences available to drinkers. That is because ethanol is far from being a tasteless substance, as is often believed. Instead, once it rises above a concentration of about 20% by volume, well above anything you would expect to find in a conventional beer or wine, it imparts a subtly bittersweet and uniquely mouth-filling quality that has yet to be replicated by any other substance. Often described accurately, if sometimes a little unfairly, as a burning sensation. This sensory quality has been ingeniously exploited by distillers to provide an almost infinite variety of taste experiences, the breadth of which far surpasses those offered by drinks made simply from fermented grape or grain. Just as in our earlier books, we will look at our subject, distilled spirits, through the lens of natural history, positioning it within the diverse contexts of evolution, ecology, history, primatology, molecular biology, physiology, neurobiology, chemistry, and even astrophysics, all in the hope of enhancing your appreciation of a liquid that hopefully reposes in a glass nearby. But we also depart a bit from our earlier format. Spirits are in certain respects trickier for the analyst than beers or wines because, particularly with barrel aging, spirits derived from vastly different sources can converge significantly over time, just as spirits within the same general category can develop vastly different characteristics. Because of the sheer variety of distilled spirits on the market, then, both in terms of major categories and of regional variations on the distilling theme, we have called on several knowledgeable colleagues to contribute or collaborate with us on some chapters that deal with specific spirits or drink types. Our deepest thanks go to all of these colleagues whose expertise and enthusiasm have made this book far more entertaining and authoritative than it otherwise would have been. As this final volume of our Natural History of Alcohol series appears, it is also appropriate to acknowledge the many contributions of Patrick McGovern, genial colleague and preeminent authority on early alcoholic drinks. Everyone who writes or cares about the ancient history of alcoholic beverages owes a huge debt to Dr. Pat, and we owe even more, because all three volumes of our series were vastly improved by his careful readings and commentaries. It is thus a pleasure as well as an honor to have dedicated this one to him. Any lingering deficiencies are, of course, entirely our own. Our thanks also go, as ever, to our wonderful editor, Jean Thompson Black, who has enthusiastically supported this series since its very beginning. Without her active engagement, we could never have carried it through, and the process certainly wouldn't have been as much fun. The same applies to our illustrator, Patricia Wynn, without whom it would by now be almost unthinkable for us to contemplate taking on a project like this. At the Yale University Press, we are also deeply indebted to Margaret Otzel, Elizabeth Sylvia, and Amanda Gerstenfeld for keeping the project on track with the greatest of good humor. To Julie Carlson for smoothing everything out with her careful copy edit, and to Mary Valencia for her elegant design. The world of spirits is, of course, so broad and deep that we would hardly have dared to take on the subject without the encouragement and support of many other fellow spirits lovers and, in some cases, mentors. Besides those who have joined us as authors, with a special extra shout-out to Alex DeVote, those aficionados include Will Fitch, Robin Gilmore, Marty Gomberg, Gene Kelly, Jacob Kolhofer, Chris Kroos, Brian Levine, Maury Rosenthal, Nancy Taubenslag, and Sarah Weaver. Thank you all, and as ever, our gratitude and affection go to our wives, Aaron and Jean, not least for their forbearance and good humor during the production of this entire trilogy. Spirits in History and Society. 1. Why we drink spirits. If a monkey could enjoy the products of fermentation, we thought, why not us? So we were a little disappointed to learn that despite the glass monkeys decorating the bottle in front of us, its contents actually had no connection to our primate relatives. Monkey shoulder is, apparently, a condition that afflicts Scottish maltsters when they have shoveled their grain too energetically. Nonetheless, we were eager to sample those contents, and our optimism was rewarded. The malt shovelers who had made this bottle possible had helped to create a satisfyingly smooth, blended Scotch whiskey. A light straw color, it offered faintly peaty aromas, enhanced with a whiff of dried apricots and a whisper of fresh-mown grass. On the palate, it was seductively smooth, with a heavy accent of salted caramel and a hint of vanilla. This was a classic blend, with a lingering finish and a harmonious integration of flavors. We hoped that no humans had been harmed in its production. Everyone knows why they like distilled spirits and why they drink them, if, indeed, they do like and drink them, because spirits, as the strongest alcoholic beverages on the market, with the most aggressive flavor profiles, take rather extreme positions on the sensory and alcoholic scales. Yet those who do appreciate the sensory complexities of spirits and the sheer gustatory variety they offer us are almost invariably enthusiasts. For them, and us, existence without this water of life would be frustratingly incomplete. As sensory beings, we are middling creatures, with neither the sharpest eyesight nor the keenest noses found in nature. But our sensory capacities are nonetheless astonishing, and they happen to be servants of a very unusual cognitive system, one that allows us to analyze our sensory inputs in a unique and uniquely satisfying way. We human beings crave any coherent synthesis we can achieve of our sensory and cerebral experiences. And at a very fundamental level, this dynamic integration of senses and intellect is what makes the experience of drinking spirits so rewarding. Still, there is no point denying that spirits also offer us the fastest way to get drunk. And although humans are clearly not the only creatures that get a buzz out of alcohol, everyone is surely familiar with those hilarious clips on YouTube that show elephants allegedly snookered on fermenting amarula fruits. Humans are the only ones, as far as we know, who perceive the intrinsic uncertainties of life and are condemned to live with an explicit awareness of their own mortality. This knowledge places an existential burden on humankind that no other species has to bear. Members of our species are uniquely capable of worrying not only about what is happening to them right now, but also about things that will or might happen to them in the future. Since we know that our lives are uncertain and fraught with hazard, we tend to welcome anything that will help distance us from this unpleasant reality. Alcohol, through its relaxing and distracting effects, helps us keep that distance, and spirits offer both an effective and a sociable way of delivering that happy sucker. What's more, on those hopefully more frequent occasions when we are not burdened with angst, we warm to the general lessening of inhibitions and the sense of connection with others that alcohol can provide. As long as excess is avoided, the benevolent effects of this remarkable molecule reliably prevail. Patrick McGovern, the leading authority on ancient alcoholic beverages, has also pointed out some possible roles of those beverages in prehistoric times. He notes that at a time when synthetic drugs were not available and your lifespan, if you survived birth and childhood, was 20 to 30 years, a fermented beverage's health benefits were obvious. Alcohol relieved pain, stopped infection, and seemingly cured disease. He points out that alcohol has always been easily administered by drinking or by direct application to the skin, and he suggests that in times before modern sanitation, the drinkers of fermented beverages, in preference to frequently tainted water, lived longer and consequently reproduced more. Additionally, herbal or tree resin compounds with medicinal properties could also be more easily dissolved in an alcoholic medium than in water. While, besides the sheer psychoactive delight in the newfound beverages, fermentation produced more nutritious, sensory appealing, and more preservable foods than the starting materials. What's more, in its role as a social lubricant, alcohol served and still serves to bring people together as a group by breaking down inhibitions between individuals. McGovern also stresses that the mind-altering effects of fermented beverages, not to mention the essential mysteriousness of fermentation itself, help explain how readily those beverages were incorporated into religions around the world. Without a doubt, then, life in a world without alcohol would be very different than the one we know, and, to most of us at least, much less appealing. All these positive aspects notwithstanding, Homo sapiens is perhaps most convincingly defined as a species compelled to take every excellent idea to a crazy extreme. Of all the alcoholic beverages out there, spirits are unquestionably the most readily abused. Society needs to address this serious issue rationally, even if it is clear that, in moderation, spirits effectively offer solace when needed and, under happier circumstances, unique sensory delights. Another way to answer the question of why we drink spirits is to point out that we can. We tend to take our limited tolerance for alcohol pretty much for granted, but the plain fact is that ethanol, the alcohol in drinkable spirits, is toxic to most organisms. Indeed, some scientists reckon that the ancient ancestors of yeast, the microorganisms that produce the alcohol that spirits makers distill today, initially made the stuff to poison the other tiny creatures with which they competed for ecological space. Ironically, even the hardiest of yeasts willingly poison themselves when the environmental level of alcohol created by winemakers and brewers exceeds about 15% by volume. And if any other organism wants to ingest alcohol and live, it needs to find a way to detoxify it. In creatures like us, this detoxification is carried out by a specific class of enzymes known as alcohol dehydrogenases, ADHs. In humans, these molecules are called ADH1A, ADH1B, or ADH2, ADH1C or ADH3, ADH4, ADH5, ADH6, and ADH7. The ADH1 molecules are found in all animals, and in humans they make up about 10% of the total enzymes of the liver. ADH4 molecules are present in the tissues of the tongue, as well as in the esophagus and stomach, and are thus the first enzymes to interact directly with the alcohol you consume. Alcohol dehydrogenases are responsible not only for breaking down alcohol, but also for maintaining in the cell a steady stream of a small molecule called NAD, nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide, that is used in energy production. In 2015, scientists compared the distribution of ethanol targeting ADH4S among a dozen species of primates, members of the diverse mammal order to which we humans also belong. Representing a broad cross-section of the primates, those species ranged from some rather distant cousins, the bush babies of Africa and the aye-ayes of Madagascar, to monkeys from both the New and Old Worlds, to our close chimpanzee relatives and our own Homo sapiens. When they analyzed their results, the researchers discovered that some 10 million years ago, there was a dramatic switch in the human lineage from an ancestral ethanol-inactive form of ADH4, the same one found in almost all other primates, to an ethanol-active one. This change, which resulted from a single gene mutation, led to an amazing 40-fold increase in the body's ability to metabolize ethanol and thus to neutralize it. Interestingly, this crucial change occurred before the separation of the lineages that led, on the one hand, to the modern African apes, the gorillas and chimpanzees, and on the other, to us humans. This means that we share the powerful new enzyme with those apes. So what happened? Well, in evolution, things don't have to happen for a reason. Mutations of the genes that compose our genetic code are happening all the time. These mutations are spontaneous, occurring merely as copying errors in the genetic code when cells divide. They consequently happen entirely at random, unrelated to any effects they might have, beneficial or otherwise. And whereas most of those changes will be eliminated quickly by natural selection, changed genes that don't get in the way too much may simply persist or, due to sheer chance, may actually spread in a population, especially a small one. In other words, genes don't have to be actively advantageous to survive or even to become the norm. So it's perfectly likely that the new form of ADH4 arose merely by chance in the lineage that later split to give rise to the African apes and humans, and because it posed no disadvantages, and it's very hard to imagine how it would have, subsequently spread by random processes in the small parental population. It is also possible that the new enzyme might actually have been advantageous to its possessors, and that it became fixed in the ancestral population for that reason. Indeed, in the introductory chapter to their book, Alcohol and Humans, A Long and Social Affair, the anthropologists Kimberly J. Hawkins and Robin Dunbar propose that the new ability to deal with naturally occurring alcohol might actually have saved our ancient ancestor from extinction. They argue that around 10 million years ago, the apes, members of a formerly very successful and diverse forest living group that was by then in decline, were coming under increasing pressure from the flourishing cercopithecine monkeys. Specifically, those apes found themselves in competition with those monkeys for the ripe fruit that composed the core of their diet. According to Hawkins and Dunbar, the monkeys held the digestive advantage in this competition because they were able to process fruits at all stages of ripeness. But there was one source of fruit for which they could not compete, namely the overripe stuff that had fallen to the forest floor and that lay there gently fermenting, as rotting fruit will do once invaded by wild yeasts. That fermentation produced alcohol, a new ingredient that, the argument goes, placed this particular resource off limits to the monkeys, which lacked the magic enzyme needed to deal with it in any quantity. The newly alcohol-tolerant human chimpanzee ancestors could therefore munch on those fermenting fruits as much as they liked. Well, that's a very nice story, and one would like it to be true. But since fermenting fallen fruit could only ever make up a small proportion of the diet of even the most dedicated, large-bodied frugivore, and because chimpanzees today, let alone humans, have pretty varied diets, we feel it's a bit dubious to propose a causal link between the new enzyme and our ancestral diet. It is also clear that the remote human ancestor in question lived a very long time before our own precursors had become the generalist omnivores that their descendants remain, which also suggests that the new ethanol-active ADH enzyme was not associated with anything that humans or their precursors did, either recently or long ago. That is, while the new and improved alcohol dehydrogenase might well have helped one lineage of ancient apes to get through some tough times, ADH is unlikely to have originated in that context. Still, whatever the actual circumstances of this notable physiological innovation may have been, we can confidently conclude that, down the line, its ultimate effect was to pre-adapt more recent humans to handle ethyl alcohol, and millions of years later, when humans figured out fermentation technology, they were positioned to take full advantage of it. Fermentation requires sugar, and sugars abound in nature, largely as a result of plants' efforts to attract mobile creatures to eat their fruit, and thus to disperse their seeds. Nobody knows for sure when humans began to deliberately ferment sugars. That's because, prior to the invention of pottery early in the Neolithic, New Stone Age, period, around 9,000 years ago, any fermentation vessels would necessarily have been made from perishable materials, of which we obviously now have no evidence. There's one possible exception. The archaeologist Oliver Dietrich and his colleagues once suggested that some hewn limestone basins at pre-pottery Neolithic levels of the Turkish site of Göbekli Tepe might have been used for brewing beer some 11,000 years ago. Lately, however, this team has been more non-committal, referring simply to cooking of cereals. Still, whatever the case at Göbekli Tepe, once durable pottery had arrived on the scene, it seems that everybody was busy fermenting whatever was available using a variety of independently conceived approaches. The earliest evidence we have for deliberate fermentation comes in the form of chemical residues that were absorbed into the pottery fabrics of vessels found at the early Neolithic site of Jiahu in northern China. There, at around 9,000 years ago, or very shortly thereafter, residents made a fermented grog, or mixed beverage, from honey, hawthorn fruit and/or grapes, and rice, thus combining the ingredients of a beer, a mead, and a wine. A fermented beverage recently reconstituted from these natural products and marketed as a beer came in at a respectable and intentionally targeted 9% ABV, alcohol by volume. Farther west, the earliest fermented beverage yet documented in the form of residues left behind in pottery jars is a grape wine from the Republic of Georgia that was made around 8,000 years ago, and to the south, in Mesopotamia, by about 5,000 years ago, the very early Sumerian civilization was not only awash with beer, but also ruled by an elite class that flaunted grape wines as a symbol of authority. It is clear that people all over the world were quick to put their existing enzymatic prowess to the test just as soon as they had the technology to do so. And however we may choose to rationalize or even dismiss this evident fact, humans everywhere are plainly attracted to alcohol, even as they are often repelled by the consequences of consuming it to excess. This strongly implies that even if the regular consumption of alcoholic beverages appeared relatively late in the history of the human species, that was only because, at first, we did not have the technologies necessary to produce and store alcohol in quantity. The predilection for alcohol was always there, lurking in the background until the conditions were right for expressing it. This observation is hardly a surprise, for not only is alcohol consumption a feature of human cultures throughout the world, but other creatures enjoy a tipple too. The most famous of these other creatures, at least among scientists, is the pen-tailed tree shrew of Malaysia. This tiny, 2-ounce mammal is renowned for its ability to binge off the naturally fermenting nectar of the Bertam palm for hours at a time, while apparently enjoying the experience for much more than its purely nutritive value. Since the nectar ferments to an ABV of almost 4%, about the same as a traditional English beer, this long indulgence means that the tiny animal may easily consume the human equivalent of 3 bottles of wine in a single session. Yet it does so with no sign of inebriation, which is lucky, because dangerous predators abound in its habitat, and any relaxation of vigilance could be fatal. Nobody knows exactly how the pentail pulls off this remarkable trick. Its ADH enzymes have yet to be characterized, although a close relative has been tested and found to possess the common form. Almost equally famous for its love of naturally fermented alcohol is our fellow primate, the Panamanian howler monkey, although, alas, this closer relative is indeed prone to inebriation. A quarter of a century ago, researchers noticed a howler feeding with unusual enthusiasm on the fruits of the astracarium palm. The individual became so frenzied that the observers suspected he might be drunk, a state confirmed by analysis of the partly consumed fruit he kept dropping to the forest floor. Initial calculations suggested that the 20-pound monkey had consumed the equivalent of 10 bar drinks in a single binge. This observation made the biologist Robert Dudley wonder why the monkey was so fond of alcohol. His conclusion? The answer lay less in the alcohol itself than in the highly nutritious sugar that was being naturally fermented to produce it. Howler monkeys are principally fruit eaters, and, like humans, they come from an essentially fruit-eating ancestry. They actively need ripe fruit and can deal with a little alcohol. Indeed, primates share some so-called inebriation genes with relatives as remote as fruit flies. What's more, while the presence of desirable sugars in any non-fermented ripe fruit has to be indirectly inferred from its color, fermentation sends out strong fumes that can be detected at a distance by a keen nose. Consequently, if a frugivore is guided by scent to a ripe and incidentally but rewardingly alcoholic fruit, its diet will automatically be improved. This is an obvious advantage for the individual and, on a larger scale, for its species. Hence Dudley's drunken monkey hypothesis that views our own human predilection for alcohol as an evolutionary hangover. But if there is anything causative in the ADH4 story, and even if not, one has to wonder why more frugivores did not acquire the new version of the enzyme. After all, the mutation concerned is a simple one, and we know it occurred more than once among the primates, since Madagascar's strangely beautiful II also boasts the modified enzyme. Closer to home, our very close relative, the chimpanzee, shares our improved ADH4 with us, so it would perhaps be surprising if members of its genus did not occasionally capitalize on that fact. And indeed, it turns out that chimpanzees occasionally do indulge in a quick tipple. Researchers at a site called Bosu in the West African country of Guinea have reported seeing chimpanzees emerge repeatedly from the somewhat degraded forest in which they live, heading for a nearby plantation of raffia palms. Not much for them there, you might think. But it turned out that plantation workers were tapping the raffia trees to obtain sugar-rich sap that dripped into plastic containers. Inside those containers, the sap rapidly and spontaneously fermented into an alcoholic palm toddy, which, depending on time elapsed, would achieve between 3 and 7% ABV. While the workers' attention was elsewhere, the chimpanzees would descend on the plantation and scoop the alcoholic liquid from the containers, cleverly using crumpled leaves as sponges to soak it up. In our experience, palm toddy starts off as a sweet and delicately flavored beverage, but by the time it reaches the alcohol levels at which the chimpanzees consumed it, it is generally very pungent and, to us, little short of repellent. But wherever it was in its taste evolution, the chimpanzees evidently loved the stuff, dipping and emptying their sponges on average every few seconds, for minutes on end. It is hard to know if the chimpanzees liked the toddy because of its gustatory qualities or because of the buzz they undoubtedly got out of it. Observers reported behavioral signs of inebriation. But based somewhat unscientifically on our personal opinion of excessively fermented palm toddy, we're guessing the buzz played a significant role. Anthropologists Ruth Thompson and Anya Shoka, however, wanted to find out more. After reading about drunken monkeys, ADH4, and the Bosu chimpanzees, they set up an experiment. For 10 days, they offered some zoo chimpanzees daily treats consisting of apple puree, either with or without rum flavoring. After showing some initial interest in the rum-flavored samples, the chimpanzees lost any preference, leading the researchers to conclude that they did not prefer alcohol-rich fruits more than non-alcoholic fruits, and thereby to reject the drunken monkey idea. But looking a bit closer, we found that the apple puree was not flavored with actual rum. Doubtless because of some footling bureaucratic requirement, the substance used was a rum flavoring rather than the real thing, and the alcohol level in the puree was a mere 0.5% ABV. In other words, the most we can conclude from the experiment is that chimpanzees don't care much for non-alcoholic rum substitutes. We have no idea whether a good dose of real 80-proof rum in the apple puree would have changed the result. But we like to think that the Bosu chimps were going for the buzz. Whether or not chimpanzees actually like alcohol, it is clear that we humans are not alone in our attraction to alcoholic beverages. But we are unique in our dual ability both to produce alcohol at will and to consume it in relatively large quantities. And it seems that, from the beginning, considerable ingenuity and effort went into the human production of booze. The earliest producers of alcoholic drinks fermented whatever suitable substances they could lay their hands on, clearly aiming for the alcohol itself as well as for flavor. The categories of beer, wine, and mead were sorted out only later, according to tradition and the principal resources at hand. Distillation came along pretty late in the history of human alcohol use, almost certainly due to the fancy additional technology required. But once the new approach was on the scene, its manifold possibilities were assiduously and enthusiastically explored, with the result that today every bar features a vast range of distilled beverages for clients to try. The world of alcoholic drinks is a pretty ecumenical one. There is room behind all but the most specialist bars for a full complement of beer, wine, and spirits, and nowadays, even mead again, suggesting that it is part of the human psyche to wish to enjoy alcohol in all of its expressions. What is more, most drinkers recognize that appropriate occasions exist for consuming all of these kinds of drinks, so that instead of being in competition, they are, in the main, complementary. After all, while you would not want to slake your thirst with grappa on a hot day, chances are you wouldn't wish to accompany your tiramisu with a sour ale. Alcohol's most wonderful property is its ability to deliver a wide array of textures, flavors, and aromas, and so to satisfy the human craving for sheer gustatory variety. 2. A Brief History of Distilling. Before tackling the history of distillation, we felt we had to sample a product from Europe's oldest, more or less continuously operating licensed distiller, located near Ireland's rugged, wind-swept northwest coast. Granted its initial license to distill in 1608, even before the Bushmills Old Distillery Company was formed in 1784, the current Bushmills Distillery has long carried the banner for Irish whiskies, triple distilling its creations in rows of traditional squat, long-necked copper stills. This was the 16-year-old bottling, made from a bill of 100% malted barley. Its components had spent their first 15 years in casks, previously used either for Oloroso sherries or for American bourbons, before being assembled into large port pipes for 9 months of finishing. The end result reflected this complex history. Golden in the glass with reddish highlights, this whiskey presented on the nose as fragrant and distinctly fruity. It gave our palates toffee and dark fruits, as well as hints of sherry, all superimposed on the rich, malty backbone contributed by the traditional mash and those gleaming, old-fashioned pot stills. We could taste every part of this whiskey's storied journey, from mash to glass. Next time you prepare some salty soup or stew on the stove, put a transparent cover over it and let it come to a boil. After a few minutes, you will see some condensate form under the lid. Carefully remove the lid, tilting it to collect some of the drips. Taste those drips, and then taste some of the stew from which it was derived. There should be a big difference. The condensate should taste neutral in contrast to the salty stew. What you have just experienced is a simple form of distillation, a process that uses heat to vaporize and so to separate different compounds out of a liquid mixture at different temperatures. For example, ethanol, the desirable form of alcohol, boils at 173.1 degrees Fahrenheit, while water boils at 212 degrees. So, if you heat up a liquid, a wine, say, that contains both to an intermediate temperature, the alcohol will boil off and can be condensed and collected separately, while the water will stay in its receptacle. But beware, poisonous methanol will vaporize before the drinkable ethanol does, so distillers must discard the heads that come out of the still first, as well as the tails that come out at the end. The sweet spot for any particular application is somewhere in the middle. Because the alcoholic wash you start with is full of compounds other than methanol and ethanol that may or may not be desirable in the final product, and that also have their own boiling points, modern distillers use a technique called fractionation to tweak the target temperature and achieve the desired result. It is not known exactly when and where the basic principle of fractionation was discovered and put to practical use, but fortunately, that has not stopped historians from speculating. On April 27, 1906, in an address to the annual meeting of the United Kingdom's Institute of Brewing and Distilling, the food scientist, Thomas Fairley, presented a stimulating discussion of the early history of distillation. His exposition was well received by the audience at the Queen's Hotel in Leeds, and it generated a great deal of discussion. In framing his talk, Fairley leaned heavily on a pamphlet written in 1901 by the soil scientist Oswald Schreiner. Fortunately for us, Fairley's address was published in the Journal of the Institute of Brewing, and Schreiner's pamphlet has also survived. Both publications are rich with illustrations, and although both are written in the quaint language of the 19th century gentlemen scientists, they contribute several important ideas about the early history of distillation. These include speculation on where the first distillation apparatus was invented, observations on the shapes of early stills, and some suppositions about the origins of alcoholic beverages. Perhaps the most insightful bit of speculation in these works is Fairley's remark that a knowledge of the art of distillation might arise in different countries independently. Fairley recognized that many cultures had boiled food and other substances since antiquity, and that it wouldn't have been a big leap to realize something significant was happening when steam was released. To Fairley, the invention of stills and distillation was just a few small steps away from this realization, which might have dawned on people in various times and places. To support his claim, Fairley points to the variety of distillation apparatuses that have existed and are used to this day in cultures around the world. In his discussion, he ranges from ancient Greece and Rome to Egypt, Arabia, Europe, India, Ceylon, Japan, China, Tibet, Bhutan, the Caucasus, Tahiti, and Peru, drawing from accounts by such historical luminaries as the Greek Aristotle, the Roman Pliny the Younger, the Alexandrian Zosimus, and the Arab Gebar, Jabir ibn Khayyan. Fairley also notes how, from time immemorial, sailors have obtained potable water by boiling salty seawater and collecting the condensate. Aristotle himself had been aware of this, writing in his Meteorology that seawater can be made drinkable by vaporization. Other liquids behave in the same way. As for the origin of the word distillation, Fairley explains that neither the Greeks nor the Romans, who between them gave us the roots of most of our modern scientific and technical terms, had a word that held this exact meaning. In fact, the only way to describe a distillate in Latin would be via some circumlocution, such as re succum subjectis ignibus exprimare, the expressed juice of the matter subject to the fires. Nonetheless, like most scientific terms, the English word distillation does have a Latin root, coming from the Latin noun stilla, a drop, via the Latin extension distillo, later simplified to distillo, and finally modified into the modern English form. Given this origin, it is not surprising that in the early days the notion of distillation had a more generalized meaning than it has today, referring to the separation of the light part of any fluid from the heavier stuff via the process of drop formation. It was only in the 14th century that the term began to be associated explicitly with alcohol production. Back then, of course, nobody knew what alcohol was, merely recognizing that the clear liquid resulting from distillation had distinctive effects when ingested. Right up through the 18th century, distillates were simply thought to be alternate forms of water. Given the knowledge of the time, that was entirely reasonable. Any clear liquid derived from the process of heating and condensing would have looked just like water to people who hadn't taken college chemistry. Indeed, in his Paean to Spirits, Pliny the Younger said, "Oh, wondrous craft of vices! By some mode or other it was discovered that water itself might be made to inebriate." It is no surprise, then, that early references to alcohol typically call it a form of water, as in aqua vitae, Latin, eau-de-vie, French, and even the Celtic ushkaba, all of which mean water of life. The word alcohol itself was said by Fairley to originate from the Semitic word kul, also kohol or kol, which was in prominent use in both the Arab and Hebrew languages. Kohol referred to a fine powder obtained by the distillation of an ore, and it eventually came to stand for any compound or substance that is fine or pure, with the Arabic article al added, al-kul, the word alcohol was born. As we will see, European usage was initially associated with the early meaning of distillation, which, according to the chemist Norbert Cockman, referred to any separation operation that included filtration, crystallization, extraction, sublimation, or mechanical pressing of oil. That's a pretty broad category. Perhaps the most engaging part of Fairley's address involved his explanations for the names given to the variously shaped stills that have been created. Because those shapes resembled animals, he established a veritable zoo of distillation flasks. Hence, we have the struthio, named after the ostrich, Struthio camelus, or the testudo, named after the turtle genus, testudo, and the multi-headed apparatus called the hydra, after the Greek mythical beast. It is difficult to pin down exactly when the first still was invented, largely because devices of this kind are found in so many cultures, and except for those found in Western Europe, we have very little information on the age of distillation processes used today. But we do know for sure that distilling came along after beer and winemaking, because it is from those lower alcohol content beverages that spirits are usually distilled. This observation narrows down the origin of spirits distillation to sometime after 6000 BCE or so, but that still leaves a substantial time gap before we have specific records that anyone was actually distilling. It didn't help that in 296 CE, the Roman Emperor Diocletian, fearing that any success by alchemists in their gold-producing endeavors would debase his coinage, declared war on these people, the first recorded distillers, and had their manuscripts burned. Indeed, most of our knowledge about the early existence of stills in global cultures dates from as recently as the century of exploration between 1500 and 1600 CE, though the explorers' records are supplemented by some much earlier archaeological indicators as well. Based on surviving historical evidence, some scholars claim that Persia was the birthplace of the still, pointing to well-established practices of distilling rose water and rose oils in this region. Other historians believe that the source was India or maybe Egypt. Perhaps more suggestive evidence comes from archaeology, which points toward the Fertile Crescent in the Near East, a 5,500-year-old Sumerian site in Mesopotamia, has yielded incomplete remains of what may have been evaporation vessels belonging to devices used to distill substances like essential oils, rose water, and wood turpentine. Though such rudimentary stills were not very efficient, once the basic condensation design had taken hold, improvements soon followed. Most importantly, outlet pipes were run from the collection trough to a collector vessel on the outside of the device, and better cooling was achieved by moving the collection through to the cooler lid, or by actively cooling the collection device with wet sand or water jackets. We can view these advances as part of a genealogical process in which the great-great-grandchildren of these innovations became what are broadly known today as pot stills. Following Cockman's lead, we can divide the history of distillation and the development of stills in Western Eurasia into roughly five major periods: the pre-classical to classical period, 6000 BCE to 700 BCE, the Arabian Alembic period, 700 to 1450 CE, the Renaissance Science period, 1450 to 1800 CE, the period of industrialization, 1800 to 1950 CE, and the modern period of integration. We have already taken note of the sparse evidence remaining from Neolithic to classical periods. Let's now look at the four later periods of distillation history. The transition to the Arabian Alembic period is marked by the widespread introduction of the alembic-style pot still. This device, according to the 4th-century alchemist Zosimos of Panopolis, had been devised a century or two earlier in post-Alexandrian Egypt by an enigmatic figure known as Maria the Jewess, who was possibly also the mother of alchemy. The word alchemy comes from the Arabic al-Kamet, or Egypt. Zosimos described the still illustrated in figure 2.3, a style that comes from early 1st millennium CE Greece and is variously known as the still of Democritus or the alembic of Synesius. It has four components, and its design served as the basic model for alchemical stills well into the 2nd millennium. The alembic helmet on top is connected via a pipe to the receptaculum, receiving vessel, below, and the heating apparatus, called the cucurbita, because it was shaped like a gourd, is labeled in Greek characters and supported by a tripod. Simple stills of this general kind were widely employed by Arab alchemists from the 8th century and were commonly used right up to the Renaissance. The word alembic, now used for a distilling device consisting of two separate vessels connected by a tube, ultimately stems from the Greek root ambix, meaning cup. This etymology would seem at first glance to support the idea that the device originated in post-Hellenistic Egypt, but the term alembic itself actually comes down to us via the Arabic word derived from it, al-inbik, indicating the root by which its name arrived in modern European languages. Those early pot stills are also referred to as helmet stills and were more than likely invented by alchemists. Arabian influences in the Arabian alembic period are well documented from the 8th century onward, as Arab science flourished and many people in the Near East became well versed in chemical and alchemical processes. We have already mentioned Jabir ibn Hayyan, the inventor of algebra, al-Jabir, who was also the leading chemist of his time. He noted that the products of distillation were flammable and recommended that distillation be accomplished using glass vessels because of the material's non-reactive nature. Some of the alchemical writings attributed to Gaber were translated into Latin, and the knowledge they contained was duly transferred to European cultures, discussed in Chapter 3. Significantly, while the Arabs were evidently more interested in distillation as a means of creating essential oils and other non-alcoholic essences, once the alcohol-loving Europeans had learned distillation, they soon began using the technology to convert wines and other fermented beverages into high-alcohol spirits, following a sort of less-is-more attitude. Early distillation in Europe was usually undertaken by alchemists, and at first, the distilled products were used mostly as medicines, an application that was apparently given a boost during the Black Death of 1347 to 1350, when the alcoholic beverages didn't cure, but were the best palliative available. The science of distillation reached a new level of sophistication when, early in the 14th century, alchemists refined two distinct approaches that were highly dependent on the shape of the still: ad ascensum and ad descensum. The ad ascensum approach co-opted rising vapors to form the distillate, while ad descensum employed downward vapor flow and was eventually largely discarded. Another development in the early Renaissance science period was the invention of the deflagmator, a small receptacle attached to the pipe between the cooling cap and the collection vessel. This ingenious device was designed to capture and separate out components of the distillate that the traditional procedure had allowed into the final solution. As the condensate ran out of the heating vessel via the cooling cap, the less volatile fractions would precipitate and drop out before the more volatile ones, like alcohol, did. Alchemists created this bypass point because those less volatile compounds were of interest to their work in alchemy, but drinkers were thrilled because they wanted those compounds out of their grog. The deflagmator was a win-win in all possible ways. Most distillation today descends from the Arab-European tradition, but that doesn't mean that the potential for concentrating alcohol was not also being tried out in other parts of the world. Timescales are hazy, but sometime prior to Spanish colonization, people in the Philippines were probably already making the spirit known nowadays as lambanog. This liquor is made from coconut or nipa palm sap that is obtained in much the same way as other palm toddies, tubas, that are common in the tropical world and beloved by the Bosu chimpanzees. Historically, lambanog was produced by the double distillation of sap that had fermented for 2 days on hearth-driven stills made up of two pans or wood barrels connected by a hollowed log. That double distillation process more than likely resulted from incorporating Spanish distillation techniques into older local methods, and it was certainly being practiced at least as early as 1574. Crude as the equipment might appear, its use resulted in a smooth, vodka-like spirit with very high alcohol content of 40 to 45% ABV on first distillation and above 80% on the second. Although aficionados prize the purity of lambanog, Modern versions made on more up-to-date equipment are sometimes marketed in flavors ranging from cinnamon to bubblegum. China's deep history of distillation is better documented. Distilled spirits were already being made in that ancient land by the time Marco Polo arrived in the 13th century, as confirmed by the remains of a 12th century still at Qinglong in northeastern Hebei province. Whether distilling was an independent indigenous development or whether the practice came from the West along the Silk Road is not yet entirely clear, though most authorities believe that there was a connection. Whatever the case, it is certainly appropriate that one of the oldest operating distilleries in the world is found in China at Luzhou in southern Sichuan. Using the techniques described in Chapter 17, this venerable establishment has been producing baijiu since the mid-16th century. Another closely related Eastern distillation tradition comes from Mongolia. As the result of Russian influence, there are currently hundreds of vodka distilleries in Mongolia, but traditional Mongolian spirits differ greatly from vodka. Fermented mare's milk, or erik, kumis in its Turkic rendition, is the most notorious Mongolian alcoholic beverage. It is not a product of distillation, and at 2-3% ABV, it is mild compared to other Mongolian alcohols. But it can be made stronger through the kind of freeze distillation believed to have produced the earliest Russian vodkas, discussed in Chapter 10. It can also be converted into arki, a traditional Mongolian spirit that is widely produced in Mongolian households, although mostly from the fermented cow's milk yogurt known as kefir. To make arki, the kefir or erig is placed into a concave wok on a stove. A bowl-shaped collection device is then placed over the wok, supported by a cylindrical collar and enclosed on top by a concave lid filled with cold water. When heated, the kefir releases its alcohol, which condenses into the cold lid and drips into the central bowl. After two passes, the collected condensate is ready to drink as a clear beverage of about 10% ABV. The taste of the arki at this stage is a bit rancid for those not accustomed to it, and further passes to raise the alcohol content only accentuate that flavor profile. Returning to Europe, the major shift from the Arabian alembic period to the Renaissance science period has been attributed by Cockman to the invention of the printed book. Movable print is one of the major factors that drove science and culture generally in the Renaissance, and it allowed for the wider distribution of distillation recipes and procedures that, until around 1450 CE, had been restricted in Europe to monasteries, medical schools, and apothecaries. Using the new communication technology, several authors from the late 15th to the mid-16th centuries spread knowledge of distillation far and wide. Distillation experts of this era also wrote about important concepts of brewing that were under development. Most important, the best materials for making the distillation vessels were explored extensively, with glass, clay, and other ceramics being used as materials for both alembics and collection vessels. Copper and lead were also used for both these purposes, but alchemists initially steered away from using these metals because they reacted with the chemicals they contained. Alcohol distilled from a lead vessel would, for example, turn milky white, alerting the alchemist to the fact that something untoward was happening. The resulting toxic material was fortunately rejected. Copper, in contrast, was soon discovered to remove the sulfuric compounds that formed in many distillates. Because sulfur is the distiller's curse, producing unpleasant vegetal and rotten egg aromas in the product, copper has been favored as a material for alcohol stills ever since. By the end of the 15th century, the Rosenhut hooded still had been developed, mainly for the isolation of medical liquids. This kind of still was an ingenious all-in-one structure, complete with a fire area for heating the material, a built-in conical heating vessel, a connected cooling cap, and an alembic arm. The use of steam rather than direct fire to warm the heating vessel was another innovation of the early Renaissance period. Cockman points to the 16th century French astrologer Claude Dariot as the first European to use steam distillation, an important advance because it allowed the alchemists precise control of the temperature of the material being distilled. The technique involved boiling water to produce steam that would rise to gently heat the vessel holding the material to be distilled. The rest of the distillation then proceeded as usual. Other means of controlling temperature in the distillation process were also developed in this golden age of stillmaking, most of them involving improved heat transfer. The steam method demonstrated how incredibly important temperature control is in any distillation procedure, during both cooling and heating. Many alchemists had simply used the air around the still to cool the distillate, and some distillation apparatuses still use this age-old method of cooling. But another early method was to use a water jacket, which involved passing the exit pipe through a bath of cold water that could be changed when the heat transfer became too intense. The next advance was to have cold water constantly running through the water jacket around the exit arm of the still. Either way, the water jacket not only allowed for better control of the cooling phase, but also reduced the chances that the heating vessel and exit tube would be cracked by intense heat. A related advance was the invention of coiled cooling pipes, often known as worms. The coiled pipe lengthened the route through which the distillate had to pass on its way to condensation, resulting in more efficient cooling, especially after the coils had been incorporated into the water jacket. Equipped with the advances made during the Renaissance, later alchemists had a well-tuned device with which to ply their trade. But a funny thing happened on the way to the industrial period. Science flourished, while alchemy faded away. This transition ultimately led to the creation of three different kinds of stills: laboratory stills designed to fill the needs of rigorous science, industrial stills for mass-producing compounds important for commerce, such as the sulfuric acid required to dye the linen and cotton fabrics that became popular during the Industrial Revolution, and stills for producing medicinal and recreational alcohol, already a thriving business during the late medieval period. One good place to begin the story of distilled beverages is the year 1500, when Hieronymus Brunswick's book Liber de Arte Distillandi, one of the earliest printed works on spirits distilling, was published. Fun fact, when it was translated into English in 1527, this book's simple title, Book of the Art of Distilling, became The Virtuous Book of Distilling. Why virtuous? Well, that had everything to do with the view of distillates as a gift from God. For Brunswick banged the drum for spirits as a miracle cure for almost every disease imaginable, as his book's English translator, Lawrence Andrew, rather awkwardly declared in his preface, "Behold how much it exceeds to use medicine of efficacy natural by God ordained than wicked words or charms of efficacy unnatural by the devil invented." In other words, at the turn of the 16th century, the products of distillation medicine of efficacy natural, were seen as gifts given by God to cure many of the ills of the day. What a difference a century makes! Contrast Andrew's note of solemn veneration to the tone adopted in 1618 by his compatriot John Taylor in his Penniless Pilgrimage. Taylor's carefree subtitle says it all. How he traveled from London to Edinburgh in Scotland, not carrying any money to or fro, neither begging, borrowing, or asking meat, drink, or lodging. This subtitle prepares us for such immortal lines as, "And I entreat you, take these words for no lies. I had good aqua vitae, rosa so lies, with sweet ambrosia, the god's own drink, most excellent gear for mortals, as I think." Taylor, self-described as the King's Majesty's water poet, watermen of the time were notorious drunkards, clearly enjoyed some strongly alcoholic beverages as well as vast quantities of ale during his jaunt from London to Edinburgh, and certainly not in pursuit of a healthy mind in a healthy body. In less than a century, there had evidently been a big shift among Europeans in the use of the products of distillation, all the way from alchemical medical purposes to applications that advanced the development of modern chemistry and chemical engineering, to the creation of inebriating beverages that the population drank for fun. Perhaps it is not entirely coincidental that this was also the time that Europeans began to distill sugarcane from the New World to make alcohol, discussed in Chapter 14. When the impecunious John Taylor made his trek to Edinburgh, the spirits he drank were the products of alembics that Zosimos of Panopolis might have recognized. That was because one major technological innovation was still needed before alcoholic spirits could truly be mass-produced. As it was, traditional pot stills produced alcohol in batches. A given amount of wash would be vaporized and condensed, and then the still would have to be emptied and cleaned before the process could start again. What is more, even the most efficient modern pot still, hugely more effective than in Taylor's time, will not produce a spirit of more than 30 to 35% alcohol by volume, ABV, from a beginning wash of 12% alcohol or thereabouts. To produce a stronger spirit, the distillate must be passed through the still multiple times in a process that not only raises the alcohol to the desired level, but also ensures the elimination of many of the wanted or unwanted compounds that were present in the initial wash. Pot stills can sometimes be pretty large. One monster constructed early in the 19th century held 143,000 liters. But using them is nonetheless a time-consuming and labor-intensive business, and the purity of the resulting spirit is limited. Spirits that could be manufactured on a truly industrial scale thus required something more efficient. Enter the column still. Both an Irishman and a Scotsman are credited with the invention of the column still. But this epochal event did not happen before several ingenious chemists and distillers, notably in France, had added some important innovations to distillation procedures in the late 18th and early 19th centuries. Some of the devices invented in this period even approximated column stills, but due to the vagaries of the patents process, credit for the column still that we continue to use today is shared by the Scotsman Robert Stein and the Irishman Aeneas Coffey. Stein initially conceived the column still, patenting it in 1828. His design was a huge advance, both over the pot stills we have so far encountered and over the mostly incrementally improved versions that had come into use during the decades preceding his patent application. Stills made to Stein's specifications, however, required frequent cleaning and were limited in the purity of the spirit they produced. Coffee took Stein's concept and ran with it, patenting his own improved version in 1830. The result is now known as the coffee or continuous still. Continuous stills work on the principle of fractional distillation. Pot stills produce a distillate that contains many kinds of molecules, congeners, along with the ethanol. But coffee stills conserve only a fraction of what is being distilled, producing high-grade alcohol, usually 95 to 96% pure. Above this level, water and ethanol form an azeotrope, meaning that they assume the same boiling point. The end products of continuous stills are thus typically diluted before they are bottled at around 40% ABV. The big physical contrast between the pot still and the coffee still is the tall two-distilling column set up in the coffee still versus the single and usually bulbous distilling vessel of the pot still. The coffee still has two long vertical columns, the first called the analyzer and the second the rectifier, both heated by steam. Steam is allowed to rise in the analyzer at the same time as a wash descends the column through a series of levels at which perforated plates are placed. The alcohol from the wash is passed through to the rectifier, where it is circulated, condensed, and collected. The neat thing about the coffee still is that the starting material can be cycled endlessly through the two columns, so that production can continue uninterrupted. The coffee still enjoyed immediate popularity among spirit producers and was adopted almost everywhere, except, ironically, in the inventor's native country, home at the time to the world's biggest whiskey industry. Most Irish distillers felt that, despite the higher alcohol content it delivered, the coffee device was deficient when it came to the taste of the distillate. They had a point, because continuous distilling efficiently removes most of the contaminants and trace elements present in the original wash, and so eliminates more of the congeners that give the flavor and bite that make Irish whiskies so cherished by drinkers around the world. Although coffee's compatriots lacked enthusiasm for his continuous still, Stein's home country of Scotland gladly adopted his invention, using it to make the Scotch whiskies that were mainly destined for blending. Ultimately, this led to the divorce between whiskey and whiskey drinkers, as recounted in Chapter 3. Some American and Irish whiskey makers eventually adopted the coffee still, and today, both pot stills and continuous stills are used in those industries, although worldwide, many more spirits are produced on continuous stills than on alembics. Although it is hard to generalize, it is reasonably fair to say that today most craft distilling is done in alembics, while spirits produced in industrial quantities come from continuous stills. But not always. Even the largest cognac houses are obliged by law to use copper pot stills, while many craft distillers, notably of gins and vodkas, begin with neutral, high-purity spirits produced in gigantic continuous columns. As a result, most spirits categories on the market today may be made on either kind of still, and there are now hybrid stills that make the original definitions and rules all the more confusing. Because of the relative inefficiency of the process, most spirits made in alembics are distilled more than once, with twice being obligatory for cognacs, though Armagnacs get only a single pass, and 10 times or more are sometimes claimed. But be careful when you see any spirit made in a continuous still that claims to be multiply distilled, as many vodkas do. That claim is basically meaningless and likely to be advertising hype. A tall column may have many dozens of those perforated plates, how many distillations does that imply? 3. Spirits, history, and culture. People have been making spirits for a long time, and doubtless nothing available on the market today tastes much like the liquid that dribbled off the very first still. But how about a spirit made by Europe's oldest surviving distilling company, according to a 200-year-old recipe? Presented in a tall, slender bottle, this unaged Geneva had the traditional Dutch malt bill of rye, corn, and wheat, a direct descendant of a spirit that was first shipped to America in the early 19th century and that subsequently helped spark the cocktail revolution. It had been triple distilled in copper pot stills before being infused with a separate botanical distillate. Unctuously clear in the glass, it gave off a powerful nose of juniper berries with a trace of freshly crushed mint over a strong, malty base. These dominant flavors, gently warmed by the prominent alcohol, lingered on the palate and were accompanied by a hint of crunchy celery in the finish. We were happy to drink this delightful, complex spirit entirely on its own. But then a small twist of lemon zest transformed it into an altogether brighter and more expansive experience. And we understood immediately why 19th century American bartenders had latched on to its potential to add kick and personality to a whole range of classic cocktails. Knowledge of the principles of distillation may extend back to classical times in the West and to Han times in Eastern Asia, but more important from the spirit drinker's point of view was when those principles were used in the widespread production of recreational beverages, a breakthrough that was probably achieved in Europe only in the 14th century. This relative recency means, of course, that the cultural roots of spirits drinking are historically a lot shallower than those of wine or beer consumption. Still, after a half a millennium of recreational distillation, those roots have become no less deeply and widely entrenched in local human behavior. For beer, wine, and spirits, while all containing alcohol, play roles that are much more complementary than competitive in the human experience. By the time distillation developed, societies worldwide had long been drinking beer, wine, and other fermented beverages. 16th century Spanish conquistadors rapidly discovered that the consumption of alcohol was entrenched throughout the southern New World from Mexico to Chile, with a bewildering variety of social drinking customs to match. The Inca Empire, centered in Peru, was, for example, fueled not only by the mildly narcotic coca leaf that sustained peasants laboring at high altitudes, but also by the consumption of chicha, a brew that was usually made by fermenting chewed or malted corn. Chicha held a central place in Inca ceremonies undertaken to celebrate the harvest and to propitiate the gods, and it was sometimes force-fed to human captives awaiting sacrifice. Even the hard-bitten Spanish conquistadors were appalled by the large volumes consumed in the wake of such ceremonies. A few years earlier, their compatriots who had landed farther north had been equally amazed by the huge variety of rules that governed the consumption of pulque, fermented sap of the agave plant, among the relatively abstemious Mesoamerican Aztecs. As usual, those rules revealed a conflicted attitude toward alcohol. Nobility accepted, only adults over 52 years old were allowed to drink pulque at will, and the populace in general was sternly warned about the dangers of the legendary fifth cup of pulque, other than at specific moments in the ceremonial year. Oddly, though, those Aztecs, with the misfortune of being born on the day known as two rabbit, were expected to live their entire lives in a constant state of stumbling inebriation. A few centuries earlier, traveling Europeans probably would have been surprised at the relaxed attitudes toward alcohol consumption that prevailed in the Near East, given the Quranic injunctions that inveighed against it. From the 8th through 12th centuries, under the influence of the Abbasid Caliphate based in Baghdad, a golden age occurred in Islamic science, medicine, and philosophy, even as Europe lingered in the Dark Ages. And the Islamic literature of the time bears witness to some pretty impressive free thinking about alcohol as much as about anything else. For long before the Romans, who were famous enophiles, absorbed the now Islamic lands of the eastern Mediterranean into their empire, wine drinking had been a tradition in the region. In the 7th century, the Prophet Muhammad himself propounded a view of paradise in which the rivers flowed with the precious fluid. Although Muhammad eventually concluded that humans could not be trusted with alcohol on this earth, others soon begged to disagree. The immensely popular late 8th century Persian poet Abu Nuwas frequently harked back to pre-Islamic tradition in his vociferous enjoyment of wine, pointing out with immense practicality that although wine is forbidden, God is in the business of forgiving sins. 3 centuries later, his fellow Persian Omar Khayyam was still able to pen some of the most eloquent verses ever written in praise of wine. It was not until the mid-13th century that a Mongol invasion and the sacking of Baghdad put an end to the era of such ruminations as, "I often wonder what the vintner buys, half as precious as the thing he sells," while a strict and humorless theology began to reassert itself throughout the core of the Islamic world. Venturing even farther east in the late 13th century, the Venetian traveler Marco.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.